We're not actors or TV personalities. We're just a couple of guys who want to show you how to restore your car. Sometimes we mess up. Sometimes we consult the pros. It's never a problem. It's always a project.
This week on Autorestomod, Jeff calls the 65 a bunny, Gina disagrees, while the lads install a set of Eaton Detroit Springs and give you tips to make it an easier job.
Order a bunch of parts to get ready for the car show this weekend?
And I got a hot deal, too.
You think? Think again.
Oh man.
Tired of back orders? You need NPD. With four strategically located superstores, orders are shipped direct to your door within 1 to 3 business days. National Parts Depot has quality restoration parts for Ford truck, Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, and Firebird. For your free catalog, visit NPD online or call toll free.
Be real careful when I'm setting this because it's got to be just so. Line it out, lay it down very gently, and snap the end.
Bunny?
Yeah, bunny. Think about this thing, man. When you guys were driving it the other day, you and Mike, it was just hopping like mad, right?
Yeah, but bunny? That doesn't sound very tough. How about hair?
What are you talking about, like a hairball?
I don't know, like a wild rabbit, a hare.
Nobody says hair hop.
Or jackrabbit.
Nobody says jackrabbit hop. When you're talking like in the gaming world and you're blowing stuff up, people are talking about people bunny hopping. They're not talking about people hair hopping or jackrabbit hopping.
A jackrabbit start makes a hop. Jackrabbit. Well, we're going to put the new springs on it. That problem's going away.
That's true. We got the Eaton Detroit springs. I'm going to put those on. So yeah, okay. Yeah, well, anyway, it'd be kind of funny to leave it on there for Gina to find, though.
Oh, yeah, she'll love it.
Bunny? No.
So you're excited, you've got your new parts in, they're all here in the shop. But one thing I recommend that you do is take a good look at them as soon as they come in the door. And the reason I say that is this, there may be a little problem here or there, or maybe something that you need to take a look at. If you go over them as soon as they come in the door, like our springs that we got from National Parts Depot through Eaton Detroit, and if we had an issue, we could go right to National Parts Depot to solve that issue. Doesn't happen very often, but sometimes it does. And that way, you're doing it when it's still fresh. The parts just got in, they remember you from ordering them a couple of days ago, you can go in and solve the issue. Make sure everything's in the box that you need, because the last thing you want is to be in a position where you're starting to work on the car and you don't have everything. Say you're missing a bolt or something that you should have with the kit. Maybe it fell off an assembly. No way to know. But if you go through and make sure all the parts are there, you'll have everything you need when it's time to get busy, like we're fixing to on this 65 hardtop. Okay, now one of the things you're gonna run into is taking the shocks off. It's one of the first things you're gonna need to do when you're working on the car doing this kind of a setup. Now, I'm just gonna take a mirror and show you where the shocks on a Mustang are. In a hardtop, these are really fun to get to. In a fastback, you actually have to take the deck plate out of them. Some cars are not going to be set up this way. Some cars aren't going to be using the spear ends like the Mustang has. They're actually going to be using a through bolt underneath the car. So depending on your application, that's one of the things you're going to have to deal with. But one of the first things you have to do is to take the shocks out. That's what we're going to start on right now. Okay, now we've got the original, well, not the original, but the shock that was on here when we got it, and this is a gas shock. And the reason you know that is it'll do this. But this thing is slap wore out. So even if we weren't going with the QA1 shocks from Eaton Detroit Spring, we need to replace this one because it's just not in good shape. Now I got a tip for you here. One of the things you may run into when you're doing this kind of stuff is you may run into a case where the shock wants to spin. And there's usually a little flat tab on the bottom of the threaded section of the shock right down there. Now, you can do this and try using a crescent wrench on it, but sometimes with these shocks, if they've been on there for a while, you're not going to be able to get that to come loose. So what you're going to need to do is what we've done here, which is to go in and put a clamping plier on the shock itself, like we're showing you on the shot here, and then put your wrench on the bottom and just take it off that way. Anytime you're working on a classic car like a little Mustang here, safety should be a paramount thing. And in a case like this, we really recommend you putting a set of wheel chocks on the front of the car because with these up here, you're pretty sure the car is not going to roll away. And the reason for that is, well, the back end of the car is up in the air, so the driveline is in the wind. And with that being the case, there's nothing to hold the car in position because the emergency brake on most vintage cars is out back. All right, now while Vinny's working on the stuff on the other side of the car, getting the plates pulled loose, I wanted to go over some safety stuff, and basically that's this. When you jack the car up, make sure you put the jack stands at the factory jacking points, and they'll usually show you that in the service manual. And another thing we like to do is we like to put a tire underneath the chassis of the car to make sure that it's supported safely. If something happens to the jack stands, the car will at least fall on the tire and not completely kill you. But the next thing I want to talk to you about is this. Now, when we're setting this up, you'll notice that we've got the axle all the way down on the springs. We've taken the shocks out, so this thing is fully extended. And the reason we did that is this. We want to be able to take the plates loose so that the axle is sitting on the springs and the plates will drop right off. If you pick the axle up at this point and try to do that, it's not going to work. So what we need to do now is to go in and take the plates off the bottom, get those completely loose, then we'll use the jack to jack the axle up. Okay, now what we're doing is we're going in and taking the bottom plates off. And basically what I recommend doing in this case is what Benny's doing here. The springs are all the way collapsed out with the weight of the axle on them. That being the case, you're not going to have to worry about the spring or the axle rebounding once you take the plates loose if you got it up on jack stands. Now, after we get done taking the plates off, we are going to pick the axle up, put it up on jack stands, basically just to get it out of the way. Got mine. All right, I'm going to jack up the axle. What are you doing?
Oh, it makes a pretty neat tuning fork noise.
Let's get to work.
All right.
Mate, stabilize the axle, would you?
Got it.
Jack's loose underneath there. I'm gonna go stabilize this one side. But basically, now we start working on the spring. Look, Vinny, safety first. They actually put a retaining nut on the 8-inch long shackles.
Right, we won't replace the shot springs, but we'll put safety nuts on them.
Oh, golly. Now, I always recommend taking the rear ones loose first, because then you can possibly rotate and find out if you're going to have a problem on the front of the springs, on those eyelets. That's where your major issue is going to be if you're going to have one. So, when you're doing this, work from the back to the front, because you may have to get a reciprocating saw after those eyelet bolts, because sometimes they get frozen inside the shaft assemblies. If you want to do this and save somebody else some work, maybe put some never sees on the shafts whenever you're putting this all back together, because otherwise, they can be a real pain to get out. Right. Now, I'm going to try to pull the bolt out.
Well, there's the washers.
The washers are coming out. All right. Now, that gives you an idea of just how long an 8-inch shackle is. Yeah, they use double nuts, but quite frankly, they really didn't do themselves any favor because that's far too long. All right, Vinny, let's get the other one done. All right. We've taken quite a bit of time to get the front eyelet bolt out. And Vinny right now is going to go ahead and pull the shaft assembly out. But what ended up happening is we actually broke the end of this big bolt off using an extender on our ratchet. Now, sounds like he's about got it done. We'll drop the old spring out. Now, we got really lucky in our setup. And what we're going to tell you is this. There's another way to do this. If you don't get so lucky, let's just say that the bolts are frozen inside of the isolator, and that can happen and does, quite frankly, happen quite frequently. So what you'll need to do then is to get a reciprocating saw with a very sharp blade and actually go along the outside edge of the spring, cut through the rubber and through the bolt, and then you should be good to go. Now, I'm not saying that this is going to be easy. It's not. To do what we're talking about with this is going to be pretty tough. But it's really the best alternative to doing what we did, which was basically going in and soaking those bolts every couple of days until we got them completely ready to go and were able to bring them loose. Otherwise, it's a reciprocating saw and a lot of time cutting. Now, we will put the new one back in. All right, now what we're gonna do is get the springs up into position here. Basically, I'm gonna help Vinny kind of guide it into alignment. This can be kind of a tricky little deal. You gotta get it over the top of the muffler if you've got duals on the car. So you're kind of having to wiggle around with it. Now that's just not fair. Now we did the other one off camera, and of course, that one fought every inch of the way.
It's because I did this one.
Now, whenever you're setting your springs up, you don't want to tighten everything up until you get the actual suspension down on the ground. So what we're going to do now is we're going to go ahead and get the back section put into the car. And when we get that done, then we will get everything aligned up after we set the car down. Plate going on, we're just about ready to put the axle down on the springs and light setting our position on that. All right, these are actually lock nuts and they'll tighten up as they go on. They're actually directional too. If you try to put them on one way, they're very, very tough to get on. But if you go in and you put them on in the correct direction, they will just basically thread on and then get tight, and that's when you go in and actually finish the tightening off. All right, now all we gotta do is go in and drop the axle down on the spring after we get our spring clamps set. And we're almost ready to set this thing on the ground and do our final adjustments.
Okay, we just have one more shock plate to mount. And remember, at this point, everything is just hand tightened.
All right, we're at the point now where we're gonna go ahead and jack this setup up, take the jack stands out, and get ready to set the rear axle down on the suspension. So Vinny, let's get that up in the air. All right, it's up. Get that.
Yep, we got the passenger side. Let me grab the one we had on the drive shaft setting on.
Okay. All right. I'm going to drop this in. Now what we're going to do is we're going to make sure that we've got good position on the axle assembly here, and then going to go ahead and start tightening up the bolts, get everything final set. Okay, now what you'll want to do, you're going to need to make sure you have the same distance on the threads and that the clamps are actually up against the axle on either side, and that there's the same number of threads on the front and on the rear of your clamps here on the axle. Now, the reason we're doing what we're doing is, what'll happen is when you set this down on the suspension, it'll take a set. Kind of like what we've done in the past when we set up the front suspension on a car. You don't want to tighten the upper control arm in the down position. You want to tighten the upper control arm in the up position where it would normally rest on the tires. But what we're going to do now is we're going to put the tires back on the car and then actually set this whole assembly on the ground. All right, Vinny, it's the moment of truth. Yeah. All right, all we got left to do now is to tighten everything to torque specs, and whatever your car is, that's what your torque specs need to be. So use your factory manuals to determine what the torque specs on your vehicle need to be. Torque your setup and then take it for a test drive, come back and do a final torque on it, and you should be good to go. All right, let's put it back on the air and get the shocks on it. Well, now for the test drive. Hit it, Vinny.
Yeah.
Well, so far, so good. Ooh. Brakes are crazy. That's a little project that we need to do with MPD. Good. All right, let's check this thing out on the railroad track and see how she does. That's actually not too bad. A lot worse on most cars for sure. I'm happy. Pick it up, James Cagney. See what this thing will do in the corners. Much more stable. This is a rough road too.
So, how to ride?
I'm happy, man. A lot better. You know the noises and crap that it was doing before? All gone.
Awesome.
Nice and tight, and I'm gonna go in. I think Mike said like, what, 50 miles? You're gonna go back and check everything again, so we'll do that. But man, I'm telling you what, it's much, much better. Handles a lot better. Doesn't feel as nervous in the back end as it did before. Good I'm deal. Real happy. One thing I think we probably ought to do is put a set of sway bars on this thing. Definitely. In the very near future, we have got to get some disc brakes on this car.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Well, folks, that's our show for this week. Next, we're going to be coming back to you with how to diagnose and repair a horn system in a car. We're going to be using the 65 as an example, but we're going to be showing you is common sense stuff that you need to do no matter what you're working on. So come back and watch us next week on Autorestomod.
Thanks for watching.
How do I get out of this thing?
We'll figure that out next week. Bye.
And hey.